If someone is on medication and they stopped taking it altogether, how does someone help them with that? Should they stop just taking it at once? So
I think when it comes to medication, it's extremely important that you speak with your psychiatrist. Do not start taking medication or stop taking medications at any cost without speaking to him or her. Right? Because that is to do with a very physiological process. They will be able to assist you much better in terms of discontinuing medication, especially because they have a process which is known as tapering.
Okay.
So if you don't do that, it can cause issues. So you speak to them is the best thing. If you as a person know someone else, right, which you're asking, who stopped taking medication.
If not at once, but they just stopped taking it, how do you talk to them? How do you deal with them? How do you behave around them? Because I have experienced this and I've seen this happen as well, that when something something traumatic happens to a person, people tend to behave different around them, and you want to tell them that I am still the same, you can still talk to me the way you used to talk to me. But sometimes you also want that specific attention, that someone who's had trauma. So how do you just come across and how do you say that?
So in terms of dealing with somebody who is A, gone off medication or is experiencing something, right? The maximum we can do as people is let them know that we are A, here for them. B, if they want to speak to you, hear them out. C, let's not attach, I mean, I know this is a very, very difficult thing to ask, but let's not attach any judgment to what they are saying. Okay, it can be very difficult, it's okay if you can't do it, but maybe then let's not voice it out. In terms of how can you think like this, or what, you know, you're not supposed to do this, or you're not supposed to think like this. If they stop medication, it's important to check if they've done it with the assistance of a psychiatrist or their therapist or whatever. And if not, then maybe taking them back to them and then having the proper process done is essential. Either way, if they've stopped it, I don't think you have to behave with them differently.
Okay.
All you have to do is possibly be a little more compassionate and understanding about their journey.
Yeah, but sometimes it happens that that person does need that special attention or consideration.
I think most of the times we assume that they need special attention because most people want to be treated the same way.
Same way, yeah.
Right? Because they don't want to notice that gap as to life before after. It's an event, but there's no before after. And when people around you start behaving differently with you,
it keeps reminding you of this. Yeah.
And it will just, you know, prolong that entire process. It's okay to, you can always ask them.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, say, would you like me to sit here with you? Or, you know, I'm studying, you're doing something, can I just sit here with you and do it? Or I'm gonna go out for a walk, do you wanna come along? And you can talk with them.
Yeah.
That is definitely showing support. But let's not like be scared or, you know, walking around eggshells around them. No, you don't need to do that. They're not that fragile that they would like.
So does depression also lead to anxiety and panic attacks?
Right. So generally they do say that depression and anxiety are separate, but they can occur together, which we call as comorbidity. It happens in most cases, and if someone is experiencing it, they will probably relate. Where you may feel extremely low because of the thoughts and the anxieties are related to a fear, right? And when you're so scared, it's crippling, you will tend to feel slightly low and depressed with it. It does happen with some people, doesn't happen with some, it's okay. But anxiety in itself can be really exhausting because you're on this constant survival mode where you're like, okay, I have a threat and I have to either run from it or I have to fight it, and that creates your anxiety. You will start sweating, you will start having a pit in your stomach, your heartbeat increases. All that will fall under your anxiety.
So these are the, what are the major symptoms of anxiety? Like you said, depression also has 3 stages.
Yes.
Does anxiety also have stages, and how does one deal with all these stages?
So anxiety doesn't have any stages per se, but what happens is anxiety is there within each one of us.
Okay.
Because we all feel anxious at some point or another. Like for example, I think if anybody, I think we all have given our 10th board exams. Yeah. Everyone has. and the first paper that you ever went for, everybody is anxious because you don't know what you're doing, and they would give you centers which are different, so completely alienated environment, you're in some other school. Yes, you do have this kick of adrenaline, right? That you know what, I don't know what is happening here. And that's like a threat. Don't know what is happening, but I have to nail this exam.
Yeah, totally.
That is anxiety. But it's healthy anxiety, because that is the anxiety that's driving you to do something. When this anxiety crosses over this fine line, it becomes anxiety which is paralyzing. Or when it sort of tends to form your mind. It's almost like a mental form where you're so anxious that you can't even breathe. Right? You start taking these really short breaths. And that's when there is not enough oxygen supply. There's nothing, and you're, it turns into a full-blown panic attack or something.
Okay, so what are some things that you can, like legitimate things that can, that you can do if you want to calm yourself from a panic attack, or if you have major anxiety, like what are a few things that you can do?
So I think different people cope very differently with anxiety, right? Because everyone has triggers. So for some people, just seeing something can trigger them. Right? So maybe first understanding what your triggers are, you know, what triggers my anxiety. If an exam triggers my anxiety and I'm anticipating it, right? That I have an exam, I'm going to be anxious, maybe we can learn and understand to prepare ourselves for it, right? So understanding triggers and managing them would be one. And B, when you already have the anxiety, how do you manage it? So something that has helped a lot of people has been something which is known as paced breathing.
Okay,
it's called paced breathing. It's a very, very simple exercise, because what happens is that you tend to start taking very shallow breaths. So what we want to do in paced breathing is we want to take a deep breath through our nose, hold it and count till 5, and then we release it through our mouth. Right? So that is what we do, and while we do it, we're going to focus only on our breathing, not on anything else. Right? So this paced breathing you can do for as long as you feel like. It's a very simple exercise which doesn't require you to do anything apart from
Like, this is an out of the box question. Is being short-tempered or being impatient related to anxiety, or you know, what is that about? Because like I have been told I'm really impatient and short-tempered, so
I think temper is something where it comes from and they are hurt. Right, for most people, let's see. Because some people who are very sad also will show that I'm angry. So it's like this thing which we call an anger iceberg. So if, even if you Google it, guys, you'll find it. Anger is like the tip of the iceberg, and there's like so much more beneath it. So what is your beneath it? You know, someone didn't do something that I wanted, but why was that one thing to be done so important? Or was it because that person didn't do it, because then I'm hurt? Right? Or is this frustration in terms of my goal hasn't been met? So then that's frustration wala anger. Which again, if you find another route, once you calm your anger, you'll find another route to it. But if a person has not done something and you say, you know, this is my mother, so how can she do this? Then it's coming from a space of hurt.
Yeah, I've noticed that. I tend to get angry at different people and not just the same person.
Because you feel that role that they are playing, this is a part and parcel, no? She's my mother, how can she not do it? Or how can she do it?
Like, I'm gently more forgiving towards someone. Like, if someone else does it, I won't be that mad. But if that specific person does it.
Exactly. Because you also feel like you're close to them. And, you know, I can. We also know that when we are getting angry with them, they play a certain role in our life, which is very important. Right? Because of which, when they don't do something or when they do something, we feel hurt. So we need to understand where the anger is coming from. Impatience, again, it depends, right? Impatience may not always fall into anxiety. Anxiety is coming from fear, whereas impatience is coming from a space where your goal is not being met. Right? Because I'm impatient, I want to get somewhere, so I'm getting impatient. I know it's a short-term thing. Whereas my anxiety tends to stem from fear, right? Where if I don't, for example, the exam itself, if I don't crack this exam, I will fail. Me failing this exam means I am a failure. For some people, not for everyone, but maybe I am a failure. Or what will the repercussions be if I fail this exam? That's your anxiety, because it's that fear that exam is the face of the fear and the whole body is that I will fail. So that's the difference between those.
Impatience
and anxiety. Also an app that you can use to manage your anxiety or your panic attack.
The Calm Boy?
So Calm I have not tried, but there's an app called Stop, Breathe, Think. Which is an app, so they have certain things known as mindfulness based techniques or grounding techniques. So they will help you sort of manage the anxieties in different ways. So you can try it out just for fun, also you can do it, guys.
Cool.
So
one more thing I wanted to talk to you about is dealing with breakups, and not just breakups, any relationships with your parents, your friends, the amount of expectations you have, attachments basically. I'm attached to you more and you're not that attached to me, and I tend to have more expectations from you, so how do you go about that relationship?
In terms of attachment, right, what happens is attachment ka koi quantum nahi hota hai. Right, there's no more attached or less attached, but we tend to feel like that.
Okay.
Right, because every person tends to have a different kind of a dynamic with other people, especially in friendships. So if you will see with even within your families, you will see that you will have a different dynamic with different people.
Yeah.
It's pretty much the same, and it's not that people are not attached to you. Or they're less attached to you, it's okay for you to sort of understand the boundary. Right? Because every person makes a different boundary around themselves.
Yeah.
Right? So for example, I may be a person who makes boundaries around myself in terms of how much I share emotionally with another person. Now that doesn't mean that I'm not attached to you. I still do consider you a very good friend and you're important to me, but my boundary is this. Because I may not feel safe again. Or vice versa.
But sometimes the efforts I am putting in, the secrets that I am sharing, if that is not being reciprocated in the same amount from the person in front of them, a lot of times they tend to be hurt.
I think we all learn to trust people very differently.
Yeah.
Right? That's why this happens. Because for some people, trusting is also different.
Okay.
Okay, and the way we express our love or trust is different. There are different languages that we all use to convey what we feel or the attachment and the love we feel for people in relationships, in friendships, in any kind of thing. So some people are more tactile, where they may be more they want to pat you or touch you more. So that is their expression of love, more tactile. There'll be some people who are more verbal, who will keep telling you things and expressing things verbally, right? And then there are some people who would send you gifts or do things for you. If you are submitting an assignment and you can't make it on time, they'll be like, okay, you don't come, I'll do it for you. But that is also still an expression that they get.
Yeah.
Right? So we all tend to confuse these things and we feel like I am putting more effort on the person is not putting. Whereas their language is different.
But sometimes I say in relationships, it's like they say I'm giving you my whole, I'm giving you my best, but what if their best is not
what you want?
Yeah. I mean, not just with a physical or an affectionate relationship with friends, anyone, whoever. You are giving your best, you really are putting in all the efforts you can.
Right.
But that's not what I want. I want something else.
So, I mean, the question to people who are saying, I don't know if you're giving your best, the question is for them first. What do you want? Right? Even if it helps you, I mean, this may sound really mundane and stupid, but write down, what effort do I want? What kind of effort do I want? What can this person do which is going to make me pacified? Okay, because the other person is not going to get a dream that she's expecting this from me or he's going to expect this from me, right? So it's okay for you to understand what is effort for me and what is effort for the other person, because your effort and that person's effort can be different.
Yeah.
For example, let's say a person who's had a lot of childhood trauma and they are learning to speak to you.
Yeah.
For them, that is an effort, right? Because they've never spoken to anybody. But then, by bits and pieces, by in small steps, they are talking to you, telling you about themselves. Yeah. Maybe not about the trauma that they face, but they're still telling you things, and that's effort for them. That may seem like no effort for you. Because we don't know what is happening.
exactly. So, and like you want that person to open up more and tell you more about them.
Yeah.
But the best that person can do is talking in the first place.
Exactly.
So, what happens when the both of them don't reach that?
Maybe we can first understand what is it that I want, right? What is it, let's say for example a relationship, what is it that, what are the kind of efforts that I am expecting?
Yeah.
What is it that I want? And then can we try and communicate what I want? Okay, and this is not just a one-way process. Let's ask the other person also to write, or you know, what is it that you would like me to do instead of what do I want, what do you want? What is it that I can do, or what would you like me to do? So that we both can make this work.
So Shuru, so many, you should tell what you are expecting, even as friends or whoever.
You can always, so why I'm saying expectation and what we want are a little sort of interlinked but not entirely the same. Because expectations we all have, but not all our expectations are going to be met ever.
Yeah.
We are going to face this.
At a point you should know when you should be adjusted and
More of being compassionate.
Compassionate.
Right?
Okay.
Because there are people expecting things from me as well as a person. But I have limitations, no. What about my limitations?
Yeah.
Because I may be physically limited, I may be emotionally limited, and because of that I am not able to live up to your expectations.
Yeah.
Right? Because I as a person have a limitation.
Yeah.
So it's okay for them to expect. It's also okay for you to say that, you know, I know you're I know you're expecting this of me, and I'm going to try my best to live up to this, but I can't guarantee you. Right? So that honesty from both ends is where we are able to be a little more understanding about it.
So where does forgiveness come in this entire picture? Like, at what point do you know that you can't take this anymore, or you should stop forgiving, or because at sometimes what happens is when you really love that person and you keep forgiving them. So I haven't experienced this, but like what I've read and what I've heard about people, that they start losing their self in the process.
Right. So there's this fine line which we all tend to blur out very quickly, especially in relationships, right? Imagine yourself as one circle and the other person as another circle, and these two circles are still two different individuals. When you come together, it's this small overlap that you will have with the same circle, this small overlap that you will have, but you are still two different people. You cannot forget that, because you are still going to have your own life, your own goals, and this is a part of your life.
Yeah.
This is not your entire life. That's where we tend to lose ourselves. Right? Because then we start putting other people's expectations, other people's goals, other people's wants, other people's needs over ours, and we neglect ourselves. And then they also neglect you in some manner.
Yeah.
So then, like, you know, there's no blame game here, but it's more to do with if we are able to see ourselves as two different circles who want to be together by choice.
And if you start neglecting yourself, the other person will also start neglecting your needs and wants.
Yeah, because people have expressed our needs. So how will they know that I need this?
Like, you don't do it on purpose, but it just happens.
It just happens, yes. Because I've shown them that I don't have any needs at all. So then how are they going to know?
Yeah, assume that.
They just assume. Yeah. Whereas, let's say if a person has been very clear that, you know, I have these things to do, and this is a particular time that I can make for you. And then the other person can work around it as well, right? Why why does one person rather need to say that I have to put my entire life out for another?
And something that I really liked was that you should stop expecting everything from one particular person.
Yes.
There are different people for different things.
Yes.
So, yeah. Like, you can't expect everything from your boyfriend or girlfriend. You have...
You're still human.
Yeah.
You know? So,
they can't be your gossip buddy. They can't be your coffee buddy. They can't do this.
Yes. Because every person is going to be different, and they're going to play like a different role in your own movie. It's like your villain and your partner can't be the same.
Yeah.
So it's that kind of a thing where you're going to have different people for different things in your life, and it's okay to have that because every person is not the same.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is the difference that's going to be there, but it's a good thing. Because then you have, your eggs are not in the same basket.
Yeah.
Not all your eggs are in the same basket. And you have multiple support systems.
Yeah.
Which is essential, because if one crumbles, you know that there's another.
There's another. Yeah. But where do we draw a line between right and wrong? Who decides what right and wrong is? Like, this is a question that I ask everyone.
Yes.
And like, who? I mean, I don't understand how do people judge someone by this is right or wrong. Like,
I think this is my favorite question to answer. So, there is no right and wrong, guys.
Yeah,
okay. There is absolutely no right and wrong. These are two words that we have devised as humans, as a society. So, what I may deem as right, another person may deem as wrong.
No, yeah.
So, it's a perception. Right and wrong is entirely a perception. There is no absolute in it.
But, like, if a lot of people are following that one particular perception, and they're calling it wrong.
Yeah.
And if I'm the only one who says that this is right for me, but everyone's turning against me, and I don't. So basically, right and wrong is also an opinion.
Yes, could be. Yes, it's an opinion and it's very personal, right? So let's say, for example, maybe this thing of opening up your DMs.
Yeah.
Right. Some people will deem this as right. Some people will deem this as wrong. Because they are like. It's wrong to say this now because you've been a bully before.
Yeah.
Fair enough, that's another person's perception of you, right? And because I've seen this and I will agree because you've possibly done something wrong. You never know, we all make mistakes.
And I think instead of just reaching out to everyone, if they even reach out to that one particular person who they have bullied, can really help.
Right, so that's why we're saying that right and wrong is a perception, and maybe it's time we keep it as a perception.
Yeah.
It may be right to you, but it may be wrong according to me, and that's absolutely fine. If we really want to go down to the baseline and the truth, the baseline and the truth is that, you know what, this thing has happened. Like, for example, a celebrity suicide has happened. Is the truth the baseline, the fact? Right?
Yeah.
If it is right or if it is wrong, who are we to decide? Because it has happened as a fact.
Yeah.
Right or wrong?
It's mostly about acceptance as well.
Yes.
So all of this works together, like everything.
Yeah, it's like these pieces that come together in a jigsaw. Yeah, because then I'm saying, okay, it was a decision that another person made. Maybe according to him it was right. I may not approve of it.
Yeah.
But I still respect a decision that he's been made. So that's very important.
How do you, like, speaking of approval, how do you stop seeking someone's approval after a point that you need that validation?
Right.
But you also just want to stop at once.
So maybe it's about why you want that approval. Ask a question to yourself. Okay, because most of these things, you know, I think we all know these things, but we don't think about it. Right? I want approval from, let's say, a friend of mine for what I'm wearing. But my question to myself then would be, why do I want her approval? Right? If this person approves it, what does it mean to me? Okay, is it about the person or is it about the sense that they have, or why is it, why do I want that approval? What need is it fulfilling for me? And let's say I don't get the then what? Does the world end? Am I not going to do it because I don't get the approval? But what about my own approval about myself?
So your own approval should be at a higher stake than anyone else's?
Yes, because those are your decisions.
Yeah.
And the ramifications of those decisions are things you will bear, not the other person. So how is that approval really helping you, and in what terms do we want it, and at what cost? So stopping it also comes from a sense where we're able to say that, you know what, I will try this. I will fail at it. People may not like it, but I will try this and see how it goes. Because until and unless we do it, we're not good enough.
Yeah, and like, you shouldn't just let someone's approval mean so much to you that you stop valuing your own.
Yeah, I think it's important to put your own
opinions,
your own perceptions about things up. Definitely be open to others and what they are saying.
Yeah.
Not that, you know, you're the right person every time.
Yeah.
Be open to what others are saying. And if aapko lagta hai that what they're saying is fair enough, yes, why not? Take it into consideration. But we don't need to let it be dominated by others. Right? If this person approves, I will breathe. If this person doesn't, I will not breathe. That's not what we want to do.
Yeah.
Approval game with
yourself.
Anybody and everybody, guys. Let's be kind, let's be be compassionate.
Yeah.
And when I say compassionate, understand your own strengths and weaknesses. Understand that if I have strengths and weaknesses, other people will also have strengths.
Yeah.
So let's be a little more considerate, more compassionate, and say, okay, you have your thing, I have my thing as well. How can we do this together? Mm.
And start respecting people's opinions, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Essentially, yes. Because I think because of the social media and stuff, everybody wants to put their opinions out there, and then they want to convince other people of their opinions. It's okay to have your own opinion. If you want to voice it, please go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
But we don't need to sit and convince other people
that this is my opinion and you should.
Exactly.
And you should be willing to change your opinion as well.
Yeah, I think that's flexibility, right? Where we're willing to consider other things as well.
Mm.
Yeah, it would be definitely a good space to have when we are able to, you know, take in two things differently.
Mm.
It's okay if you still don't agree with it. It's absolutely fine. But first, what's going on?
Exactly.
That's how maybe we can...
Like, suno sabki karo dil ki.
Yeah, you can always do that. Who's stopping you from doing what you want to do? Nobody is. I think you have enough to put together.
And if you have more questions, we would love to get back together and answer them.
Yeah.
And if you want to follow up on any of this, just leave it in the comments below or DM her or me. So we'd be more than happy to sit down again and get back to it. But thanks, Vedika. What do you say at the end of the YouTube video?
Like, comment, share, and subscribe. Yes. So please like, comment, and share. Subscribe to her channel.
Thank
and
you.
I think we will put it out everywhere so that you can do it.
Yes. Thank you.
Yes.
See you next time. Bye.